Hello, and thank you for watching Google Developers Live. This is a new show called Root Access Berlin. We are recording in the brand new studio at the factory in Berlin. The startup community is absolutely vibrant here. The factory is the place to be. It's a 16,000 square meter campus that mixes young startups, seasoned startups, and creates a fantastic emulation to stimulate innovation and new technologies. Please welcome Chad from 6Wunderkinder.
Thank you.
Chad, can you introduce yourself?
Yeah, I'm Chad Fowler. I'm Chief Technology Officer at 6Wunderkinder, which means partially that I'm a programmer. And probably mostly I am the seasoned guy in the young, fresh startup, to use your words.
All right, so the product you do is actually a very successful task manager. Can you tell us more about it? And I'll show on the screen what it looks like.
Sure, okay. So the product is called Wunderlist, and this is actually Wunderlist 2, which we launched in December, and I'm going to talk about the implementation of a little bit later. But it is a productivity tool that we pride on being simple and beautiful and just staying out of your way. So it's a place where you can capture your own tasks for personal or for work, and you can share them with others and even assign them to people and that sort of thing.
So here I have actually done that. I have created this work list, and I have shared it with you, Chad. And you have a smartphone on which you can see it. So let me add a work item for you. All right.
So
easy. Yes. Let's see how this works.
So this is our native Android application. You'll see that it synchronized and the task came through. Something I forgot to mention is we are a distributed cross-platform product. So we have a central synchronization service, but then we have Windows, iOS, Objective-C, macOS, Android, and web clients.
So yes, this looks extremely simple. I add a task, it pops up on my other devices, it pops up in the lists of people who share my list. That's super simple.
Yeah, that's what we want you to think, or that's what we want you to feel.
There must be 20 lines of code behind this.
Slightly more than 20. It ends up being a lot more complicated than that to implement it and make it be seamless. Just then, you shared one task with me. I was not currently working on it. Neither of us was offline. Mm-hmm. But it gets a lot harder when you have multiple clients on multiple platforms connected and or disconnected from the internet. So effectively, the problem that we have to solve is similar to creating a multi-master distributed database system. You may have multiple friends and coworkers that you're collaborating with that have mobile phones and desktop computers and connections via the web. All of them making updates all at the same time on the same lists and tasks that you are. So they're saving those changes locally. When they go offline, they could be saving many, many changes locally. When they come back online, they bombard the server with changes. And as you probably know, in mobile development, every connection you make is very expensive in terms of time and potentially battery life. Mm-hmm. So,
yes.
The big problem that we had to solve when we implemented this synchronization layer is how can we allow clients to batch up a bunch of requests and effectively make them all via one HTTP call and get all of the responses back all at once. So
okay.
we initially implemented that in Ruby. Our backend was written in Ruby, and we did it all in memory. And we did it.
This is what it looks like.
Yes, exactly. So the black box that says Go, the first implementation was done in Ruby, was all in memory, and that worked when we had a monolithic API that was all written in one language. But we're moving to a heterogeneous, distributed, service-oriented type of architecture for many reasons, including performance and scalability. So to do this, we decided instead of having an in-memory batch API layer, we would do a batch API service. So it takes the same format that the original thing does, but instead of just calling things in memory, it makes HTTP requests. And this is a JSON document, and it represents the request and the response. So a client would batch up potentially multiple HTTP operations, and you can see the methods are listed, get and post, and then the URIs. And then the server does all of the requests, in the initial version only serially, and then packages up the results again in a JSON document that the clients can parse.
And so you chose to recode your Ruby server in Go.
Yes.
Why Go? That seems like a no-go to add a new language that nobody knows about. You have very little competency in the wild for working with it.
Yeah. So there are a few different answers to that. One of them is more philosophical, and that is, I think it's a mistake for teams to be afraid of new languages and new technologies. I understand why teams can be. Now, when it comes to Go, Go is really easy to learn. I learned enough to do this service watching one talk at a conference from a Google engineer. So it's really good at doing concurrency. It's really good at doing networking. And in order to actually deploy Go, the beautiful thing about it is, although it has all these high-level language things that you're used to from languages that have virtual machines, there are no external dependencies. So it's really, really simple to deploy. Whereas, you know, if we were to go for JVM stuff, then we have to get a JVM stack running on our infrastructure, Erlang, same thing.
So for you, the ease of deployment, the lack of dependencies was the key. I understand that for other people, having a strongly typed language is also important. Go is that. Mm-hmm. The performance part is, I think, very important for a lot of people. Go is compiled into native assembler, so it's close to C performance.
Yep.
And the big difference from C is that it is it has memory management. So it is a garbage collected language.
Yeah, I think of it as like a modern C. You know, what I would wish C would be today is what Go is for me.
And Go has built-in concurrency patterns, which we'll dive into shortly, because that is what allows you to program this service very simply.
Yes, exactly.
All right, so now we want root access. Let's show the code.
Okay. Well, let's start by looking again at the JSON document that we were looking at a minute ago. And the reason that concurrency is interesting here is, as I said, this document could have maybe 40, 50 requests in a single batch request. And you, another way to say it is, if you have 10 requests that you're doing and each one takes 1 second on the back end, then it could either take 10 seconds or it could take 1 second, just to overly simplify.
And here it will take 1 second.
Correct.
So, but before we go there, you need to do HTTP requests.
Yep.
There are handy libraries for doing that in Go. So let's see what they look like. So this is an HTTP client. You import the library, and really the only thing there is to it is get and post. It doesn't get any simpler than that.
Yep.
And
it's included with Go. It's part of the standard library, which
yes.
is a lovely thing.
And here is how you do an HTTP server. It's the same library. And first you have to look at the main function. You declare a handler, you associate it to a URL, and then you launch the serving service, listen and serve. And the handler is, again, pretty much what you expect from an HTTP handler. It has a response writer for writing the response, and it has access to the request.
Yeah, and this is a multi-threaded server that can handle a lot of load. Just this little bit of code here, that's actually what a production Go server looks like.
Okay, so let's dive into the real code here and mm-hmm. talk about concurrency. So here is the first part of your black box. What does this do?
So this is actually the code where, given a request, one of those JSON documents sent from a client, off screen we're calling extract batch operations, which all it does is parse the JSON of this request. So we're extracting that into a collection of operations, which is what we've assigned to ops here. And then the interesting thing, and the part that demonstrates how concurrency works, is the line in red where we say RC equals make chan response. What we're doing here is we're declaring a variable called RC, which is an instantiated channel in Go. And channels are how in Go you have multiple concurrent threads, or Go routines is what they're called, able to talk to each other and send messages to each other in a thread/concurrent safe way.
So the core is the Go routine, and that is the Go statement that you see here. What does that do?
So basically what that does is we could have called request without the word Go there. This is the really neat thing about it. It's like you add Go to the beginning or right before a call, and it turns something that was otherwise done serially in the same thread into running into a new thread or a new thread. The threads in Go are called Go routines because they're not exactly threads. They happen to run on operating system threads natively, but they're smarter than that. They can multiplex across operating system threads in case one gets locked up, that sort of thing. So it's a really high level environment, and you could see with that just that Go statement, you take code that was serial before and you turn it into parallel code.
And actually, the Go runtime can also decide to run a Go routine as a thread or to batch them up inside one thread. Mm-hmm. So you can have many more Go routines that you would have been able to have threads in any operating system.
Yeah, it's a really nice high-level construct. And then, what we're doing here is we're calling the request function, which is something that we built, which just simply goes off and makes the HTTP request that we've asked for in that batch JSON, and then we pass in it this channel. So that's how the new Go routine is going to be able to communicate back to the calling code and give it the response from the batch request.
So let's see how these calls come back. What does this do? This looks a little bit unusual. There is an infinite loop on a select statement on a channel response.
Yeah, it's very similar to the select call in C. Although what we're doing here is we're asking Go to watch for I/O on channels. So we say select, which tells it to watch and block for I/O. And then we say, if we get a response from this RC thing, which is the channel we made earlier, then we can process it. And the syntax that we have highlighted here, where it says --RC, that is basically saying we're taking something out of RC. It's a kind of a clever visual syntax.
So on the previous screen, we have launched our 10 requests asynchronously. Mm-hmm. And here we are listening on the channel if one of those is returning a response.
Correct.
One of those or many of those. How are you going to deploy it? Is it physically one box?
A beautiful thing about this service is it's this much code. And I mean, it's like technically maybe three times as much code as we saw for the entire thing. But not only is it a small footprint for the developers, it's a small footprint for the server. So the way we're deploying it is we're actually just putting it on all the servers. So wherever we have app servers, which really simplifies our deployment because it's not eating up so many resources, we can just say it's a part of our standard server build and it's just always running. Like, it's just, Go is extremely quick, so.
Thank you very much for being with us on Root Access Berlin. And we hope to see you soon with other startups, other interesting technical problems, and other, I hope, interesting technical solutions. Thank you, goodbye. Thank you, Chad.
Thanks.